Good evening and welcome to the October 12th meeting of the City Council of the City of Florissant. Before we begin, I ask you to stand and join the council and myself in reciting the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Before we do the roll call of the members, I would ask that if there's anyone who wishes to speak at the hearing from citizens portion of the meeting, that you complete a speaker card. Speaker cards are located on the table next to the entrance to the chambers. And if you'll pass said card to Mr. Hessel, he'll pass it down the dais to us. Item number two, roll call of the members. Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Hanke?
Here.
Pagano?
Here.
Schmidt?
Here.
Siam?
Here.
Lee?
Here.
Jones?
Here.
Egan?
Here.
Caputa?
Here.
Shildroth?
Here.
Let the record reflect that a quorum is present. Item number three, approval of the minutes. Mr. Siam makes a motion to approve the meeting minutes from September 29th, 2015. That is seconded by Mr. Jones. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Let the record reflect that the minutes have been approved. Item number four, hearings from citizens. Again, if you would like to speak at this portion of the meeting, I would ask that you complete a speaker card located on the table next to the chamber's entrance and pass along to Mr. Hessel, who will pass it down to myself. Each per speaker will be given 3 minutes to speak, and please remember this is not an answer and question-answer session. If you have a specific question you want answered, see myself or one of the council people after the meeting this afternoon or this evening. Don Golazewski. Good afternoon, sir. If you could state your name and home address for the record, I'd appreciate it.
It's Don Golazewski, 1315 Delray.
Very good. Thank you, sir.
I wrote this down to keep it at 3 minutes. Mr. Mayor, President Egan, Ms. Goodwin, and members of the City Council. I've been a resident of Florissant for over 30 years, and in that time I've seen changes in the leadership of the city. Mayors have staunchly led and retired. Council members have compliantly served the residents and cast their votes, not always to our liking. Police chiefs have, especially by today's standards, assumed the unenviable position of keeping order. Even our own Mr. Hessel has put himself in harm's way just to help us better understand the laws that govern the way we live. There is one common factor, though, that links all of these individuals. It's that they're all driven by a duty to serve us, the residents. As residents, we all have a great stake in Florissant, and some of us have strong opinions on how things should or shouldn't be done, but as the saying goes, everyone's a critic. To guide the individual exchange of ideas and maintain stability, we follow Robert's Rules of Order. Robert's Rules of Order is a guide for conducting meetings and is designed for use in ordinary societies like ours. But there is another guide that's even more important to follow when presenting your ideas, your concerns, and your questions to this body of representatives. It should be followed no matter how you as an individual feel. It's known as etiquette. It's an old-fashioned idea. That's because it's no longer part of our daily routine. It's not practiced in school anymore, and it certainly isn't part of social media. Many parents teach it, but there are others that believe if you scream and intimidate long enough, you'll get your way. Lately, I've noticed that here, an ongoing lack of respect at these meetings, and it troubles me. I've always known Florissant to try its best to take the high road, to be an example to other municipalities on how we as a community display pride in ourselves and our city. And we've done this by adhering to the principles of honor, respect, and decorum. But it's getting tougher to do so, especially when there's a lack of respect for the rules and disregard for etiquette. After witnessing the last council meeting, I think there are some individuals that owe a public apology to this council and the citizens of Florissant for their behavior towards these principles, and especially to President Joe Egan. As a police officer, Mr. Egan spends his day dealing with the problems of others, some who have no respect for his position. So what does it say of us when he presides over a meeting at night and is disrespected by some citizens just for following the rules when inquiring about someone's residence? I don't want to witness the anarchy I see in other council chambers where shouting matches and disorder lead to a breakdown in communication, animosity, and the ability to solve issues. Even if you don't respect the individual or their questions, respect their office. If they're willing to serve us, we at least owe them that.
Thank you, sir. Mark Bellman. Good evening, Mr. Bellman. If you state your name and your home address for the record, I'd appreciate it.
Thank you. My name is Mark Bellman. I live at 768 Charbonneer Road, 63031.
Mark, can you speak up just a little bit, please? Thank you.
Mark Bellman, 768 Charbonneer Road, 63031, as part of Ward 3. We all know sales tax is easy to get passed. So here are a few comments and questions, which I understand, that will not be able to be answered tonight, but hopefully in the future. Did the city borrow monies from reserves for this year's budget? If they did, then I hope this is not going to be a money grab to boost general revenue. City residents have been misled before, speaking pertaining to the Park Improvement Fund. It is my understanding that the council could not tie up funds for future councils if the money is in a fund like a transportation fund. So what if the money was directed to an ordinance or policy stipulating no salaries, equipment, and especially the professional service fund to be used? Capital improvements need to be transparent and most importantly monitored, such as we do our own households. Questions that I have heard from many constituents: is there a reason this new tax could not be part into some kind of special fund or transportation fund? If not, why? We have the Park Improvement Fund that is currently listed, even with a subsequent under capital improvements. Will these taxes be placed in general revenue, or will they be standalone line item budget? Will the city publicize a list of items, accepted contract bids known as budget acceptance items, and final invoices of spending and completion of each of those line items repaired or replacement, offering to the residents an assurance of accountability process and procedures? Currently, the local Greater North County Chamber of Commerce, who has endorsed Prop S, is also going through a capital campaign initiative to its members. Their initiative is very thorough. They have contacted each individual member and have provided to them their own line item replacement budget. 20 individual items are described to be raised of certain amount of funds. Most of you sitting here tonight have received that list. It equates to $50,000. In the $120,000 bond issue initiative in the Hazelwood School District, over 2,000 residents originally participated in a work that ultimately provided the blueprint as to how the monies were to be spent. Committees were formed, and people in this room participated in driving the decisions of the budget. There were public forums and selected committees of work. Financial costs were provided to the patrons of the district, all before budget ballot language. Absolute final
Mr. Bellman, if you could finish, please, if you could wrap up.
I certainly hope that you all will be concerned about who's going to be accountable for these tax dollars. The residents of this community expect that and hope that will be the case. Thank you for your time.
Thank you for your comments, Mr. Bellman. Jeff Tessina. Good evening, Mr. Tessina. If you could state your name and home address for the record, I'd be appreciative.
Jeff Tessina, 4635 Whisper Lake Drive, 63033. Yeah, even though that's blackjack, it has a Florissant mailing address, as I'm sure you know. But I'm here to speak about the traffic light just before Walmart. Yeah, and In some places, all across the country, including on Route 67 in West Salton, before that light, at Route 94, there is a sign with flashing signals that says "Prepare to stop when flashing." Then people know that they'll be coming to a red light, and I'd like to see something like that in both directions just before the light at Walmart, but particularly in the northbound direction, because you can't see the light until you get ready to go down the hill. And just the other day, I was told that somebody got run over at that light already. Think about how much worse it's going to be come winter when there'll be ice and snow. That hill is bad enough in ice as it is without the light in the Walmart, and think about how much worse it's going to be going forward. That is exactly why I think that in both directions, but particularly going north, there should be a similar sign to the one they already have on 67 at 94, a sign that says "Prepare to stop when flashing," and then the lights will blink if the light's ready to turn red, or if it is red, at which point they'll need to stop. That will cut down on the number of accidents, as well as screeched and slammed brakes.
Very good. Thank you so much for your fine suggestion, Mr. Tessina.
I would like to know if this council has any thoughts on that.
Again, like I said a few minutes ago, it's not an answer and question session, but if you see one of us after the meeting, we'd be more than happy to discuss that with you.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Tessina. John Engelmeyer. Good evening, Mr. Engelmeyer. If you'd be so kind as to state your name and home address for the record, I appreciate it.
John Engelmeyer, 1281 Graham Road. It's not my
Mr.
home
Engelmeyer,
address.
I want to stop you real quick. As we said last time, we had this discussion last time regarding 1281 is not actually a residence. I have received several calls this last 2 weeks from people wanting to know why you have an address of record when you are a concerned citizen. I'm going to point out each time that is not your address, correct? Well, the card in front of me has your address of 1281 Graham Road. And we have historically at this council, we ask citizens to provide their home address. And I think it's fair, the citizens that called me this last week all expressed concerns, as this last gentleman did, that residents who come up with concerns as residents. Clearly, we have some people who are architects that come in and give a business address. They don't live in the city of Florissant. But when people listen to someone who claims to be a resident and purports to be a concerned citizen, I think they have a right to know where you live, much like they know where I live. And this council has been fairly firm since I've been on it.
Again, if that's not sufficed, I will bring my passport. My passport, my driver's license says 1281 Graham Road. I have a lot of mail that comes to my office. I leave my phone number. I'm not hiding from anybody, Mr. Egan. I don't know what you're implying or why this confrontation. I've used an address of 1281. I've signed packages, UPS packages, post office. It's 1281 Graham Road, as stated on the yellow card.
And you vote from that address, sir?
Sir, I didn't understand.
I said, do you vote from that address?
Do I vote from that address? Is that a requirement on filling out the yellow card?
Again, Mr. Engelmeyer, the people have reached out. I'm going to let you speak this evening.
And she was not a resident of Florissant. She was a resident of St. Louis County using the zip code of 63034. So I don't know the relevance to this. If anybody wants to check me out, pull me up in the phone book. I'm not hiding from anybody, Mr. Egan. Besides that, all the city council members took off their phone numbers off their website. All there are is email addresses now. In order to find out who and where you are, where I can make a phone call, I've got to search around finding other individuals who know you to get a hold of you.
Okay.
Your phone numbers are gone. Now, I'm not trying to enter and get another confrontation. Well, while the city council doesn't call pardon of order here,
okay,
I don't understand why.
Ms. Stringlemeyer?
My address of record is 1281 Graham Road.
Okay. I'm going to make a point every time you use that. That's an address of record, and it's not where you live because you indicate that you are a citizen.
I didn't say I live there. You asked the resident address, yes. And I'm not a resident.
And as long as
I
you understand,
as an address of the yellow card.
As long as you understand, each time I'm going to make note that that is an address of record,
Egan, then I will
and
enter
not a home address.
Confrontation as I'm doing right now. Once again,
let's go ahead and begin your 3 minutes.
Do what, sir?
Start your 3 minutes.
Thank you. I want to first of all thank the city council on the joint resolution that's going to be proposed tonight. I really appreciate that, trying to define better to understand it. On the Proposition S issue, again, I confront this. It's very deceptive in terms of information. I want streets. I want to see the streets approved. Action breeds action for our city. It does make a difference to the residents and to the community to see some action taken within the development of the infrastructure of our city. But to put this out, work road ahead, save streets. And then we have Tim Lowry. It indicates that it's a police problem and not a street problem. Both pieces of literature to me are deceptive, and I don't appreciate. We're old people. We're residents. We grew up here. We live here. And why are we acting in a deceptive way regarding that? Last week, the budget was presented, not to the general public, but to you as individual council members, not to the public. There was no budget address given at your council meeting, which is shameful. Protocol indicated from prior years and prior periods that a budget is always issued and talked about openly. Why are we hiding? I understood the administration distributed the budget to only the council. I pulled my budget up off the website and I printed it up myself, so not to impose a cost to the city. Tonight, there will be a discussion about it, the budget, at a public hearing. This is like putting the cart before the horse. We're having a public hearing prior to those workshops that the city council members go to and officiate at, and I, a citizen, cannot impose a comment. I can't speak. All I can do is sit there and make my notes until the first reading and second reading, and of course the third reading to the bill to adopt the budget, is the last time I can speak other than my 3 minutes. I think this is wrong to the citizens and wrong to the community. It's giving the wrong impression, once again, deception. And I don't like it. I don't appreciate it. I'm only one person, but I will speak for myself. I think it's wrong. Tonight, what else should you know about a government finance as a guide to notes and the financial statements and supporting information? Council accounts, a guide to your rights. You ought to pull up on the website and read what you're responsible. Your fiduciary responsibility is in question. I've looked over the budget. I find it to be very, let's say, non-integrated, not correct in terms of presentation. And I know Randy McDaniel. He's a good person, yet the other hand of it is that this administration, I think, is hiding, again, deceptiveness, and it shouldn't be there. You have a distinct responsibility. It's called fiduciary responsibility. If you don't know what your guidelines are, please pull up the state statutes. I have, and I've read them. Please understand, I'm not opposing. What I'm doing is addressing it openly.
Could you wrap up, sir? Could you wrap it up?
And my address is 1281, Mr. Egan.
Thank you. Kevin O'Donnell. Mr. O'Donnell, if you'd be so kind as to state your name and home address for the record, I'd appreciate it.
Good evening. My name is Kevin O'Donnell, 1281. No, I'm just kidding. 512 Rancho Lane, Florissant, Missouri, 63031, Ward 4, United States of America.
You're up.
Okay. I'm here because of Prop S. And, I am for the quarter cent increase, except I asked how much it was going to cost to put this on the ballot. Nobody knew. Nobody could even give me an idea. It was a week before the deadline to file. I mentioned this postcard I got last time at the last meeting, and I said that it didn't have any kind of who it was paid for by, so I assume it was paid for by the city, because it doesn't say paid for by the committee. As I understand, the committee registered with the Department of Elections on September 14th, which was after this was proposed to be put on the ballot. And then I came in, and I was shocked last time when I came into the city council and the around the building, and there's these signs around there that say safe streets, do road work ahead, and all this other stuff. And I also noticed that at the fall festival yesterday, it looks like there was a table set up. I was ill yesterday. I was ill both Saturday and Sunday. And I wasn't able to, I tried to make it to the car show at least yesterday, and I parked over on St. Charles Street and I couldn't make it. I got sick. So anyway, I was just trying to figure out why there's all these signs posted. They're plastered all over every wall, vending machine downstairs and everything. And I thought there wasn't supposed to be any campaigning or political signs on city property. And I was told that it's just an informational sign. So in 2017, when I run for city council again, I plan to block out the elect and post my signs all over city property, because I figured that it's okay because they're just informational signs. I can also put these on the easements, on the right-of-ways of the city, and they should stay there because these are staying there, so I think that mine should also stay there also. And so that's basically, oh, then one more thing. City employees aren't supposed to be working on commissions or anything for any kind of political commission, and this is for the city. Am I correct? Well, I can't answer. I assume that it's for the city. And I understand that the former mayor, Robert G. Lowry Sr., is
Mr. O'Donnell, could you wrap it up, please? You're over 3 minutes.
He's an honorary chairman, but we have the police chief is a co-chairman. How can the city allow the police chief to be on a commission for this political thing? Okay?
Thank you, Mr. O'Donnell. I appreciate your comments. Item number 5, communications. Madam Clerk, please read the communications.
Email dated October 6th from John Engelmeyer regarding the town hall meeting.
Item number 6, public hearings. Public hearing 1509-023.
A public hearing will be held by the Florissant City Council in the Council Chambers at 955 Rue St. Francois, Florissant, Missouri on Tuesday, This was postponed from Tuesday, September 29th, 2015 at 7:30 p.m. on the following proposition. To rezone properties currently zoned B4, Highway Commercial District, also known as 2520, 2702, 2700, 2635, 2685, 2705, 2749, and 2775 North Highway 67 to B3 Extensive Business District. To amend the zoning code section 405125 B3 Extensive Business District paragraph B to change item 13 from blueprint to blueprint shop to animal hospital. Citizens will have an opportunity to be heard. Anyone with special needs should contact the city clerk at least 5 days before said public hearing by calling 839-7630 or TDD 839-5142.
Thank you. Mr. Lum.
I'm going to place a graphic of the good evening.
Good evening, Mr. Lum.
I'm going to place a graphic of the zoning district in question. It came before the Planning and Zoning Commission. And then I do have an aerial photograph, too, that I could take up, but put up after this. But very simply, the pink-colored properties are the ones that the city clerk just read. And say a petition to rezone these properties at the advice of the city attorney. Each of the property owners were written a letter, certified mail, and I received two phone calls from two different property owners with minor concerns that their current tenants remain in place. One of the phone calls I received was from the owner of this property, 2749, and the one adjacent to it, the Johnny Max, and then the Title Max property owners. Both wondered if that property could remain its current use, and was there any developer going to come and buy up the whole block and do a big development? No. The reason why this came up was a restaurant really intends to go in across the street, maybe in this area, where this bank property exists. And it was discovered that the B4 properties, the zoning, and only had a couple of special uses that were available. One not being a restaurant's quite a surprise. So I first took a proposal to alter the zoning code to the Planning and Zoning Commission to maybe change the zoning code to make the special uses the same in B4 as B3. But instead, you have this proposal, which the Planning and Zoning Commission preferred. Since the, I think you have the staff report from that meeting, it seemed that the Highway Commercial District, which is B4, has a purpose statement that some may consider outdated. I can read it from the staff report. And that's the B4 Highway Commercial District. The purpose of this district is to provide for attractive and efficient commercial activity in a manner appropriate to such activity so as to reduce conflicts, congestion, and other hazards related to high volume and fast traffic on the highways. And it occurred to many that on Planning and Zoning Commission that purpose statement might be outdated, and so we looked at the a side-by-side comparison of all the uses in B4 and B3. So we made a side-by-side comparison and found that all the permitted uses were identical except a couple. But B4 had no special uses virtually, only two really. One, if you remember recently, a special use is to allow for a daycare center, child daycare center, in the B4 district. And so in order to look at this a little more realistically in this aerial photograph, it occurred to staff and to the Planning and Zoning that this area of the highway, this is Surrey 1, this is Surrey Plaza 2, there's an auto parts store here and a Dairy Queen here. What makes that section of the highway that's only a very short distance long different than B3? Not much in today's world. Maybe when this zone was created, it was maybe quite a bit different on the highway when the highway was first developed there. But to have identical uses and then have the special uses be completely different just didn't seem to make sense. So it did make sense to the Planning and Zoning Commission to approve or to recommend approval to you. And that's what's on the staff report, recommended approval to take these properties and rezone them to B3, and that would allow these properties the same advantages of having special uses in them, and it would also allow for the permitted uses to be made identical. So there's actually another separate bill that I speak to on the agenda just to change the zoning code to make those identical. has to do with animal hospitals. That was kind of the funny thing about it, is that the Florissant Animal Hospital is in a B3, but it's in a, but they don't have a special use, only for their sign, because a special use currently in the B3 is an animal hospital. But if you go to B4, it's a permitted use. That didn't quite make sense. So that other bill that you have in your packet is makes all of them identical. It makes animal hospital a permitted use, and the Florissant Animal Hospital will be permitted to be where it is. That's about it in a nutshell. The end result of it will be that the B4 district, there won't be any properties in the B4 district. Again, I only received two phone calls. One, a real estate agent and an owner sitting there next to his owner saying, can we still have Title Max continue? And that the answer was yes. And Johnny Max said about the same type of question. Any questions?
I see no questions from the dais. Before we close this public hearing, is there anyone in the audience that would like to make comment? Seeing none, Mr. Shildroff moves to close the public hearing. That is seconded by Ms. Pagano. All in favor? Aye. Opposed? And the public hearing shall be closed.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lum. Public hearing 15-10-024.
Notice is hereby given that the City Council of the City of Florissant will hold a public hearing on the proposed budget for the City of Florissant, including the General Revenue Fund, Capital Improvement Fund, Park Improvement Fund, Sewer Lateral Fund, the Property Revitalization Fund, and the Court Building Fund for the fiscal year beginning December 1, 2015. In the Council Chambers at 955 Rue St. Francois on Monday, October 12, 2015 at 7:30 p.m. All interested persons were invited to attend the public hearing and may present their views concerning the proposed budget. Anyone with special needs should contact the City Clerk at least 5 days before said public hearing by calling 839-7630 or TDD 839-5142.
Thank you. Mr. McDaniel, you may begin. Welcome.
Thank you. Good evening. It's a pleasure to be here tonight. The proposed budget was presented to the City Council at the last council meeting in September. It was then posted to the city website the next day so that it was available to the public. It includes the mayor's message and a transmittal letter, which provide additional information on selected aspects of the budget. If there's any questions or comments, I'll be here. Thank you.
I see no questions from the dais. If there's anyone in the audience that would like to make comment on this public hearing prior to closing, same, now is the time to come forward. Good evening. If you'll state your name and your home address for the record, please.
I didn't think it was required to state my home address. I am a taxpayer here. I do have a occupancy permit. My address of record is 1281 Graham Road.
Your name, sir?
This evening, the budget was presented.
Sir, you haven't stated your name yet, as I asked.
John Engelmeyer.
And for the record, the address you've given me is an address of record. You don't live there.
1281 Graham Road.
Thank you. Proceed, sir.
As Mr. McDaniel stated, the city budget was presented to the public as a courtesy, as I was informed earlier, because the monthly operating statement for August wasn't posted. July was late, and I wrote to city clerk and to the city addressing those issues, and I was informed that it was a courtesy, and it was really not necessarily a requirement. But I did pull up the budget. I did print it up, as I said earlier. Why the city can't be proud of $34 million budget, and we have to hide it from the general public and not even talk about it, I think is a disgrace. Again, as I talked earlier, you have a fiduciary responsibility to come up and to meet and discuss this budget. I'll begin with the issues of the, I asked for a table, by the way, but I have a slight issue here, but again, relevant disclosures, and supporting information. Governments are required to present two notes related to financial activities among the funds. One discloses interfund balances at the end of the year, and the other one is the other discloses the interfund transfers during the year, the fiscal year, amounts transferred to among other fund columns. This disclosure should also describe why the transfers were made with a single out transfer that do not occur on a routine basis or are inconsistent with the activities of the fund making transfer. That came out of the guidelines for governmental accounting. And again, as I quoted earlier, the notes to the financial statements and supporting information for government finances. As I said earlier, the annual audit office gave me guidelines to read in terms of what the objectives are of a city budget or a budget process, and what can I expect to do, and how do I request those. It is public information, either the Sunshine Law, or if I have to go to the Freedom of Information Act, I will request it. This evening, and I was, like I said, I was hoping for a chair and table, but I'll begin, and I'll take as much time as possible. In terms of the revenue side, I'm not here to discuss that. I think although relevant, the primary purpose of me talking tonight is the individual departments. For instance, the information, is this relevant to any of you, or is this something I should stop? Because I've got the whole binder here, I believe is like 136 pages or something like that. 190 pages, 90 pages. If I can go down each one or have an opportunity at your work sessions to discuss this, I'll be more than happy to back off from tonight's public hearing. Last year at your work session, I was asked to speak, and I wrote an email to you all, and I did not get a response. I showed up to work session, I was denied an opportunity to speak. And then I was informed that I had an opportunity, the third reading of the budget bill to pass on to ordinance, that I had a chance to speak after your work sessions. I think it's, as I said, it's the cart before the horse. I think a citizen needs to know what you're going to discuss and how the budget balances and expenses and what your projected budgets will be. I'm looking at a raw document prior to you, and again, I use the word fiduciary responsibility, to understand the budget in your process. Tonight, what I see here is a proposed budget. It's not the actual budget after you revamp it, revise it, look at it. Anyway, so if you want me to, I'll continue on, or will I have an opportunity at your work sessions to speak? Mr. Egan?
Yes, sir.
I just don't want to speak for myself, but does a citizen have time to speak before the city council? Can this public hearing be postponed until after your work sessions? Or does it have to be passed tonight with the public hearing?
I could not guarantee that it could happen.
You're the president of the council. You set the record for the council, correct?
I'm telling you, this is your opportunity to speak on the budget.
On the budget. Prior to your...
This is the public hearing, Mr. Engelmeyer.
I understand that. I asked a question.
And if some, I can have and an at some point in time, any member of this council could make a motion to limit the time, and that could pass, but I suggest you get the points that you need to get, sir. We're very interested.
I don't see anybody taking any particular notes, so at this point here, I don't see the relevancy to this. So, I mean, I can go down the line. Let's start with the IT budget. Telephones, $120,000, where last year, or 2 years, the actual was zero, and the budget for 2015 is zero. I have professional services of $57,800. In terms of the budget, I think it ought to be $60,000. That's my opinion, but I don't know what that consists of. As I turn the pages, I begin to understand what is the professional fees. On the professional fees, they have down here materials and supply, $10,200 underneath the IT department. Last year was budgeted $7,000. And so at this point here, what's the additional amount? Yearly maintenance and repair for security cameras at City Hall and government buildings, $3,200. Last year it was zero, this year it's $3,200. In terms of dues and traveling for the IT department, the GMIS International Conference was $591. This year it's $2,000 in the budget. That concerned me on the IT department. In terms of the intergovernmental relationship to the professional fees, not a particular issue, but that went up from cameras, Charter communication, fiber optic connectivity at $5,250 per month, additional cost for increased speed to accommodate security cameras. Again, back on the other page, it was a $3,200 increase in terms of the camera system. So I don't know what exactly that's all about in terms of $63,000 versus $51,000. On the capital additions, we have down here replaced computers, laptops, tablets, monitors, various department, approximately 30 devices, 4-year replacement cycle, $600 per. That's $20,000, where last year there was zero. Are we not updating and not taking care of our equipment on a continual annual basis? That was a concern I had. Replace park and finance servers on a 5-year replacement cycle. Should that not go into the park department and the finance department in terms of servers and not to the IT department? There's somewhat confusion on that. Housing, the housing resource center department, I had no problem particularly with the revenue side, looked at that, and the salaries and expenses. No particular issue on that page, on page seven. And going back over to the next one is legislative side. No particular issue on the salaries, I pulled it up. Although I didn't understand why the dues and travel were $27,000, so as I turned the page, it says mailing, newsletters, printing, business cards, seminars, conferences, meetings, mileage, city logo and jackets, and other miscellaneous items. In the budget, on the operating monthly budget, on the legislative side, so far $27,000 was allocated, $8,500 was spent, so leaving a surplus balance for the last 3 months of this year of $17,770. So I don't believe that $27,000 is correct unless there's something there which could be modified or adjusted as we're doing tonight on the agenda with other accounts. I think that $27,000 is way out of skew, maybe $15,000. But in terms of conferences, meetings, logos, jacks, shirts, just some concerns there. Senior department, looking at that, how many seniors are being served? I don't have any numbers there. How many seniors on how many seniors participate within the activity programs that they suggest in here, the activity senior travels? I don't have any numbers. All I see is amounts of dollars. I see the staffing and the profile. When it comes over to the building maintenance, it shows that there was window restoration on the dining center last year, this year nothing. So I assume that all the replacement of the windows were taken care of last year. The door replacement, $2,500 this year. $2,500 for a door replacement. I don't know, I don't know the condition of that. I was hoping to be at the work session so I could listen to the presentation there. Turning the next page over to the senior report. It seemed like the lunches went down rather than going up. $31,375 on the 2015 budget, $28,600 on the 2016 budget. I don't know whether the usage went down. There's no explanation there. It says 22 meals per day. I don't know the usage again. There's no numbers given to the usage. Coming over to the next page, the administration side. No particular problem with the expenses except for employee benefits. I have real issues on the employee benefits, not having it broken down to Social Security tax, Medicare tax, medical costs, dental costs, life insurance costs, or long-term disability. Did the president of the council leave? Okay. If anyone else cares to leave, I'll continue. I'll just go on. I'd like to see the breakdown of that, of those costs, employee benefits. In terms of A, human resource specialist, additional position. was last year was zero, this year it's one. So we're hiring another individual in the human resource specialist department. I don't know whether that's, again, not till I attend the work session will I understand the need for that additional position. On the resident incentive program, I show $120,000 proposed on the budget for the administration side on resident requirement incentive. It shows that we have a balance on that, and it's not as great as it shows here. So I think that's an overstatement in terms of the budget. Coming back here, next page is the consulting services. In terms of supplies and city's functions, it says here $5,500 for safe repair and safe deposit box. The safe deposit box, I thought would be within the city hall and not elsewhere off-site. I think the off-site cloud may be appropriate for the internet or for the IT department, but I didn't realize the city had a safe deposit box. On the consulting services, city attorney, we went from $192,000 to $192,000. I don't know whether there's a request for a proposal made to that. I know Mr. Hessel's been the attorney for a very long time, and for legal services, you don't necessarily have to go out for a bid or a quote, but I think at this point here, $192,000 is quite a large amount of money. It's over $15,000 a month for legal services. Legal services, as you all well know, legal lawyers cannot stop a lawsuit from happening. It's good representation, and having a strong resource is great, but yet there's a lot of good attorneys out there. On C, miscellaneous professional services, and it doesn't have anything to do with anything. It says miscellaneous professional services. What does that mean? I don't have a definition, again, of miscellaneous professional services. Legislative consulting services. Is that our lobbyist, once again, that's hidden in here and not clearly defined as a lobbyist, Mr. Green? I don't know what representation he has, because at this point here, the city council and the city has the, Legislative Resource Center. So at this point here, I don't know why we're paying for a lobbyist, because we should have good representation as a League of Cities or Municipal League. On the public relations consultant, $12,000, I don't see a definition of what their job title is or job description to better understand what a public relations consultant, and I would agree with having a public relations consultant, but looking at their description, your job specifications, and what they're hoping to achieve, I think is a great opportunity for us to sell ourselves and not be deceptive. Again, on the bank fees, it went from $12,000 to $6,000 in the general fund administration. I don't know why it went down by $6,000, other than the fact that the good negotiations with your banking facilities would help. Going over to the next page, I'll be on page. On page 20, it's the new building. We acquired a new building over a year ago. At that point, cost us a little bit over $1 million to acquire the building. It was done in a very, very hurried manner. And there we have municipal court, no issues there, but the municipal court and the judge, but the municipal new building is back on the capital improvement side. That I'll get into, because there's $258,000 appropriated for the building renovation. The more buildings we have, the more we're gonna have to have maintenance, more we're gonna have on utilities and repairs. I hope this will not be an issue in the future because of the utility cost and maintenance. Nothing in terms of that. Coming over to the health department, the flirt bus wages. I'd like to see the flirt bus wages in terms of the ridership of the flirt bus. I assume they're keeping track of it with a tally, as they would at the civic centers, keeping track of everyone that comes in. You see a better understanding of why the expenses for salaries and the benefit side to flirt bus. The flirt bus serves many citizens, but sometimes when you analyze those flirt buses, it's better off that we hire a cab service for our seniors than the flirt bus, because they don't run necessarily on a regular schedule back and forth. They say what time you pick them up and what time they drop you off. Under in terms of senior citizen buses, on page 23, kids summer program, one man, 6 hours, 11 weeks. I don't understand that. What is the purpose of the kids program, summer program, with the health department under senior citizen buses? That's somewhat, at 66, I don't know what 66 means here. It shows hours, but is it one day a week? Again, it's very confusing to me to better understand that one. In terms of the building maintenance and supplies in the health department, page 24, we have 4,000 materials to build a storage shed. In my opinion, to build another piece of equipment or another piece of building should be, in my opinion, a capital improvement, not necessarily a direct expense, should be capitalized. I asked the word earlier this year, what's the difference between capital and expense? And I got no reply. Two replacement of chainsaws at $500 is reasonable. Four replacement of weed eaters, $450 each. Seems extremely high because I do buy good equipment from the various supply houses, Tractor Supply Center, Family Center, and now the Rural King has opened up, and I've seen good prices on those. The telescopic pull chainsaw is actually, I think, a little bit low, but it's good enough for processing dollars. A one-gas hedge trimmer, $550, I think is a little bit high. A floor buffer, I don't know what prices or what quotes we got from. All I see is $1,200. I think that's a little bit too high. Two backpack blowers at $550 each. If you go to the steel center and go to the supply, Tractor Supply, they're not $550 for a good, adequate steel, as long as it's being maintained correctly and the use is done appropriately using those. In terms of office supplies for the health department and printing, it discloses here it's the copy machine maintenance, operating supplies, and maintenance underneath the health department. Materials and supplies of $33,000. There's no particular breakdown within that category, and that's on page 24 at the bottom of that. It shows that we have fogging, we show enzymes, we show Roppen, dog, cat, food traps, rodent cakes, and again, there's no particular breakdown, but it went from $28,000 to $33,000. No disclosure in terms of information. Last year, we spent appropriated $1,500 for dues and travel. I think that this year is more appropriate to $500. In terms of the professional services, again, the rat, rodent control in creeks and resident rodents, controlled by contractor. I've never seen this happen. I live on Fountain Creek, and I've never seen a rat and control operation system. I'm more concerned with the rear of the business on the Florissant roadside, Family Dollar, and the other shopping center that backs up to St. Judith. Also, the education handouts and promotion for recycling. I thought that was could be done underneath the grant program with the state. I thought the state offered grants through the Bureau of Natural Resources. And again, why we have we don't have a dollar amount assessed for that, but I thought that was through the Missouri of Natural Resources, and why we're having money for that, I don't know that. On the theater, no particular issue on that. I think the publicity, it says flowers brochure, $1,350 per mailing. I've never particularly saw a flowers brochure on a mailing, but it's in there. And the Missouri Fine Arts Council for the Valley of Flowers went from $8,740 to $8,954. And I believe Gary Gatos in his presentation at the work session will be able to maybe explain that further. The other hand is the Valley of Flowers Festival cost the city $49,000, up $4,000 from last year's budget. Again, I would yield to Gary Gatos to maybe explain that more, but I don't have any idea why the increase, because this budget does not have any index to it with reference to why the increases. In terms of the benefits on the Civic Center side and community centers, it went from 352 to 352.
According to the operating budget statement that was published August 31st, 2015, it should be about $295,300 for utilities, and that will be found on page 29. I thought the utilities of the Civic Center would have gone down with the use of the solar roof panel grant that we received, and that it would have gone down significant. Usage at the Civic Center and JJE, there's no breakdown of the utilities. I have mixed feelings about allocation of costs per center. And the theater, non-civic, underneath recreation leader, supervisors, on page 30, it says one at 25 hours per week, 52 weeks plus one plus 12 hours a week at 52 weeks, $1,924 at second year rate. And again, it says for theater. Why is this underneath the civic and community centers and not underneath the theater budget? That's somewhat confusing to me why that's allocated to the civic center when, again, as I said earlier on the funds, is that the commingling of funds should be allocated to the fund or to that particular department. Going into the next one is that the instructors on page 31, at the very bottom of the page is instructors, $80,000, $80,000 for this year. I don't believe these are employees and no setup costs. There's no setup costs for these programs that are offered through the city of Florissant. There is cleaning, advertising, setup, and utilities allocated to those instructors for the use of those rooms. And again, if we rent those rooms out, we have to pay a fee. In terms of the city having this done, there is a cost to maintaining, cost of utility, cost of advertising and setup. The advertising occurs within the newsletter from the city of Florissant. On the next page, on the resident department playground, and that's found on page 32. Looking at page 32, the revenues were $131,243 as of August. And that gave us a percentage of 92.94% of the budget that was allocated for 2015. Having said that, the playground program has basically ceased. There's no program going on right now. It only goes for a certain period of time. But yet we have an allocation that increased by over $10,000. And it came out of salaries with no distinct clarification of the effect of full-time people increased. And I did not see resident versus non-resident users in terms of resident requirement, non-resident requirement, and the fees that are charged for both. I would like to have clarification. Going over to the next page, in terms of page 34, revenues in terms of recreation department, Bangard Pool. That's broken out in terms of revenue for 2014. I thought there was an issue with one of the pools, I believe it was Bangard, with a cracked bowl or swimming pool that caused the water usage to increase and utility to increase because of that. In terms of capital improvements, I don't see any indication, and again, I would refer to Todd Smith in terms of information about that replacement of that pool or fixing or repairing it adequately to stop the usage of the water leaking. Bangard Pool, and then we go to the Koch Aquatic Center, but that's not broken down in terms of utilities versus the other ones and professional or personnel banners. Going over to the next page, General Park. General Park is everything else. Year to date was $397,000. It's very difficult to look at that and say we've got a budget of 592, this year it's 479, it's actually 397 in terms of the year to date. If you extrapolate that out, it will be less than that. So again, I'm last 2014 actual was $205,000 for the park with, again, with explanation, I'd like to see what that was. Going over to the next page, and my favorite topic, and here we go, golf course. So far, we've lost, as I sent in my email, over $338,000 this year on the golf course. And Mr. Schroeder years ago told me it was an amenity. I think the amenity needs to stop.
I don't know the answer of what alternatives there are, and I've discussed this openly with the City Council, and I've come before the City Council addressing this over the period of time and years. This is absolutely ridiculous to be spending my money. And again, I talked to you all about fiduciary responsibility, doing the right thing with my tax dollars. $338,000 loss for this year is absolutely absurd, and there's no reason for this. There's no control. The administration has let this continue, and I believe that the City Council have been playing into this, and I don't appreciate that. In terms of the revenue side, the projection for revenues this year are down to $550,000. And again, $665,000 was appropriated for 2015. And if I was to go back over and look at the monthly operating statement, we have really not even obtained that money, that much money, in terms of an overall. So again, the fiduciary responsibility comes up. On page 41, mind you, I'm just a citizen, but I drove into the golf course, driving down the entranceway, which is very prominent, which is very nice, very well done. But as I drive into the golf course, I look to the left, and I see abominable two buildings that are shameful. And anybody that gets cited for having a residence that is not brought up to code and is cited for it, and we, the city, lets those two buildings exist at a golf course, is absolutely wrong. The rear of those buildings are storage with pallets and disgusting in terms of what my presentation of this golf course should look like. Upon arrival at the golf course, as everyone well knows, there's a hill. As you go up the hill, there's no adequate, you have to bring someone down in a golf cart to pick you up, to bring you up. The parking is terrible. On the office supplies, we've got $3,000, $3,500 allocated. In my opinion, it basically should be about $3,000. Again, control factors. Going to account number 0629, the building maintenance, and it says here, it says here, plumbing, electrical supplies, cleaning supplies, linen, backflow preventer inspection, and various other supplies, includes replacement banquet tables as needed. $30,000 allocated. I don't know if there's, again, without the presentation of having the director of those particular departments available to answer these questions, only at your work sessions do I find these out. That's the issue I have. Includes on 01, building maintenance and course supplies. Includes material supplies such as sand, topsoil, sod, seed, flags, ball washers, bag stands, cups, pesticides, fungicides, herbicides, fertilizers, and other supplies. Also includes material such as pipe fitting and other necessary items to maintain the golf course irrigation. Includes soil testing and small equipment repair and maintenance. That is an issue because, again, it went from $85,000 to $75,000. Coming back in line, it's difficult to see exactly what that is, other than the fact that it shows $118,000 in the budget, and we've used about 90% of that already this year. So I don't know whether that's too low or what's going on with that particular account. Going over to the golf course budget, and I'm a member of the chamber, and on the page, so I note it, 42. On the page 42, there's a Greater North County Chamber of Commerce dues of $250. I've never seen Todd Schmidt or our golf pro at those meetings indicating that they're having it. I hear about the golf courses, hear about the tournaments, but why do they belong to the North County Chamber when the city belongs to the North County Chamber? And I see several individuals that attend those. The Northwest Chamber of Commerce is $80. Nothing significant, but I don't know how relevant that is to North County, when in fact the Northwest Chamber of Commerce is a different Chamber of Commerce than what's at North County. The VGM Club purchasing cooperative membership last year was zero. This year it's $500. Again, what was the purpose of this? And I don't know that, so I'm asking the question. Metropolitan Amateur Golf Association was never joined last year, and this year it's $150. Again, what's the purpose? And I'm not just talking nickels and dimes here. By the time I get through with this, it adds up to a significant amount of money differences. In terms of publicity, in terms of a golf course, last year was budgeted $3,000, and this year it's $1,500 in terms of the proposed budget. Why the decrease when we're trying to promote the golf course and trying to build the revenues up? But once again, it's gives me mixed signals in terms of why this golf course still exists when you're not going to be funding it. It doesn't cost to advertise, it pays. But obviously it doesn't pay well here. With the loss of $338,000 as of August. The golf course improvements on page 42, various tee, bunker, fairway renovations, prior year capital additions, $15,500 this year. So again, having said that, I'm not out there playing golf, but various tees, bunkers, and fairways, I would think that we've already had the golf course taken care of. Public Works, there's not much there for me. I think everything's going well. The salt storage building has still been a question after the bond refinancing. There was appropriation of $290,000 for the salt storage building, which I don't hear anything about or what happened to those funds from that bond issue. If you remember, I spoke on that bond issue asking for the additional monies to be sent on streets. And I was told by a council member that because of the funding and the purpose of that fund, that it could not be allocated to streets, that it had to stay within that definition of the bond. So my $290,000 is still out there somewhere, but it's mixed into this, but is it still allocated, and is there still intent to have a salt storage building? The gasoline account, in terms of on page 45, the gasoline account says major construction equipment, trucks, vehicles, tools, and public works department, fuel, oil, lubrication, hydraulic fluids, and forecast to remain high, plus inspector vehicles added to the fleet, pump and tank repairs and maintenance. So I assume that the Public Works Department, all the fuel comes out of that and not for the flirt bus. Travel, on page 46, plan reviewer, part-time inspector, building commissioner, director, city engineer, and others, less inspector's vehicles, is $20,000 allocated last year and $20,000 this year. I know we're a large city, and it was discussed in the brochure of how many miles of streets we have, but 20,000 miles within our city gives me some kind of a confusing understanding of why. And again, how many miles does that cover? I don't know. I have no clue. Again, I'd yield to the workshop, to the Public Works Director, to maybe better understand that. On the next page, 47, professional services. In terms of allocation, was $68,000 last year, this year $83,000. There's no particular breakdown of that. It shows material testing, traffic consultation, miscellaneous public work projects, design services, testing of, and it goes on further to say $15,000 for trees, trimming city trees around streetlights. Again, there's no particular breakdown of that, and I don't know the cost of that breakdown as terms of the operating statement. Last year, we allocated $530,000 for streetlights. According to my projections, using once again the monthly operating statement, it should be about $490,000. So again, my projections. In terms of the police department, the only comment I have on that one is on page 48, equipment repair vehicle, $19,586, $27,500, and now it goes to $27,800 for this year. I don't know exactly what those repairs are on a regular basis, oil changes or whatever, but that's the only thing I have in the police department as a whole. I go into the next one, the media department. We went from $215,000 budget for 2015, and we went to a proposed budget 2016 to $215,064. My projections are $185,000. I don't know why the increase, other than the fact of the repairs and then the equipment. I don't know what the breakdown is on that. I pulled the monthly operating statement to look at the comparisons. In terms of capital improvement fund, I want the true definition of what is a capital improvement and what's an expense. I think the capital improvement fund needs to have a better definition for the use and application. I think that in terms of what I read to you earlier, in terms of interfund transfers, I think it should go from this fund, not in detail, but only a fund transfer from this fund to the general fund because of the allocations. On professional services, we went from $381,000 on a budget with the actual of 2014 of $233,000 to a proposed $589,000. The street contract, again, I like that. I like street contract. And there was the quarter cent sales tax proposed proposition on the ballot November 3rd. I don't show any of that revenue coming into this budget, and I understand it. We won't know that until after November 3rd. Yet the other hand of it is that will this be discussed at a future date? If so, when? And again, it comes in late in November. The imposition of that tax may not occur until 2016. How much is expected to be brought in at that point is what I'd like to know. I think Mr. McDaniels has the monthly sales tax revenue. This is, I believe, will become point of sale and not necessarily a pooled money. So how much is expected to generate was $1.6 million a year. So will it be 10, 5/8 or what's the amount going to be? So I don't know that. And I'd like to know what the projections might be upon the passage of Proposal S. Going over to the Health Department of Capital Additions is we have a new roof replacement. I don't know what particular building is that, the building on the Health Department building down at St. Ferdinand Park. That's a $34,000 replacement. I think that, again, is that just a number or do we have something in writing in terms of a proposed contract? 148-inch zero-turn riding mower is $7,500. I don't know what particular mower that is. And again, I have a zero-turn mower. I bought a very good one, industrial use one, and it was not $7,500. In fact, it was a bigger cutting mower than deck than the 48-inch. And $7,500 seems extremely high to me. If I was a salesman, I would like to know that because I decide I'm going to be put on the bidders list and bid back. But anyway, and again, the two-way radio is $11,000 on 69, on page 69. Two-way radios, $11,000. Is there an RFP out there, or is this a fabricated number? I don't know that. I know that things have been brought before the council before with no validity, no substantiation, no support documents. I don't know what these are. Again, coming over to the Brock, Bach, Rath, Wise House Hazard Mitigation and Repairs at $46,800. And looking at the photographs online, in terms of St. Ferdinand Park, I believe that the $46,800 was not correct. I thought it was discussed in my best recollection that it was gonna be a little bit over $100,000 to refurbish this house, if I'm correct on that. It was discussed at the council meeting in terms of presentations, and we've only allocated $46,800. So what number do I believe, the $100,000 or the $46,000? I won't know that till I get to the work sessions, if I have an opportunity to speak. On page 71, the police department cars, motorcycles, and equipment is equipment repairs. When it talks about police cars, department cars underneath equipment repairs, should that not be allocated to the police department and not to this capital improvement fund? That's where the confusion comes in. Is this in addition to the police budget, or is this the amount for the capital improvement should be an intergovernmental transfer allocating that as terms of fund balances, in my opinion. The golf course and vehicle equipment, once again, in line 3 of page 71 on count 0330, says golf cart vehicles and equipment. In the golf course budget in the department, there is money allocated for vehicles and repairs. So why is it within the capital improvement budget? Are we doubling down on this? I don't know. I am very confused in the presentation of this budget. Going into the next page, the ID department. The ID department, over the past several months, and I'm not trying to point fingers at anybody, but has been issued because either it works or it doesn't work. In some cases, the internet goes down or the website goes down. I tried to pull up the last council meeting. I still haven't saw that one yet. But again, going down to Capital Addition Public Works, we have a dump truck of $132,000. Again, is that a number? Is that a real number? Is there a request for a proposal? Do you have documentation? Is there a quote or some kind of a guideline for that? And again, engineering for that Bach Rath Wise house is $46,800. I asked the question again. I thought it was going to be more than $100,000. Building public works counter and office remodeling at City Hall, $48,000. Is there a request for proposal or is there blueprints of what's supposed to be done? Is there something there? I don't know that. Normally you go out for bid, but I haven't seen anything on the bidding process yet because this is a proposed budget for 2015-16. And I don't know whether it'll stay in there or not until I attend the work session. Park Improvement Program, Improvement Fund. It's a dedicated account for park improvement. And we see all these expenses listed here. It's a fund that should be allocated. And again, because it's a separate fund, it should go to the allocation of fund balances and transfer of fund park into the various accounts. Is this including, or does it include the golf course in terms of the various expenses, or is the golf course still a standalone? I've asked this question before in terms of the park fund. I'd like to know the true expenses and what these are used for. The resident incentive program is this park improvement fund. Why is that a park improvement? That's not a park improvement. It's very confusing reading these. And again, I'm not trying to be a jerk. I'm trying to understand the budget that's being presented to the citizens of the city with no distinct relevancy to what this document is. It's a deceptive travesty to have this kind of document. Look at various other cities. See how they're proposed. Oscillating fans for the golf course equipment, $16,800. Now, I don't know what kind of fans they are, but for $16,800, I'd like to be put on the bidders list because I cannot understand $16,800 without having an information supporting document to indicate what we're buying here. Is that 20 fans? Is that one fan? Is that how? It's an amount with no detailed explanation. And it says here, golf course improvements. Now, earlier I talked about the golf course. And here's the improvements. Various tee, bunker, and fairway renovations. $15,500. I just addressed that in the golf. Now, again, it's addressed here in the capital the park improvement fund. Why are we mixing the funds? Why doesn't dedicated and be true, be truthful? Why are we mixing funds? And one of the comments I made earlier was the crack in the swimming pool, loss of water. Is that going to be posed in this year's budget? Because there was a concern last year to Todd Schmidt that we had issues, and it's not being addressed, to my knowledge, in this budget. If it is, I'd like to know where it is, because it should be either fixed or we close down the pool. And again, on page 78, concrete tee pads and disc golf course at Dunnicutt Park, $7,000. I don't understand. The disc golf course is there. I know that the city maintenance crew mows around it, but I don't know the breakdown of the golf tees or the tee pads for Dunnicutt Park. I don't know the breakdown, or is this a number? Page 78. Okay, on 78, there's a laser level field at Coke Park and field at St. Ferdinand Park, $39,000. I don't know what that is, and I'd like to have a detailed explanation to better understand why $32,000 for a laser level field. I don't understand the purpose. Again, not having detail or supporting documents doesn't help me to better understand the presentation here. Turning over to the next page, on 79, at the very bottom of it, 0921-45, summer playground staff t-shirts, Why doesn't it come out of the summer playground program? Why is it in park improvement? This is very, again, deceptive. Why doesn't it just come out? It's a great, it's part of the advertising for your playground program where the staff does have their shirts. I think it's very becoming, very professional. And yet it's mixed into the park improvement fund. How is t-shirts an improvement? Again, I got issues. And then on 80, what I was really shocked to see was underneath account 0928. And it comes under 44 centers. And it says beer for facility functions and concessions. Beer? We're selling beer? I know we have a cater license or something of that nature over at the Civic Center. But beer? I didn't know that. I thought it was against state statute to buy alcohol for municipalities, cities. But it says beer. I thought, whoa, I didn't know we had beer. But anyway, I thought that was really interesting. And then, on that same page, building maintenance and supplies, backflow preventer inspections and repair for JJE and JFK, $1,200. HVAC maintenance, $5,000. On that backflow preventer, I don't know what that exactly is, but I'm going to try to find out myself. So, I don't have adequate supporting documents for any of this to better understand the proposed budget. On this page, on Park Improvement Fund, we have a roof repair and maintenance of $7,500. What particular roof or repair is $7,500 within the park? Which ones are they? There's not allocation to the which park. I know we have many parks. So which particular park is this? I don't know that. I've driven around most of the parks to see, but I don't know which one until, again, the work session and Todd Schmidt presents his information. And the information on page 81. On the top of that page says fitness center equipment, maintenance, and supplies is $10,000. And yet down at the very middle of that section, replace existing recumbent bike machine in JFK Fitness Center and replace existing stepper and stride machine in JFK Fitness Center. It has basketball hoop adjusters, and it has also relocation existing surveillance camera from JJE to the Nation Center, $3,000. I am really confused on that in terms of why we are allocating for new equipment, and yet we're replacing new equipment below. So that should be added to that, not as a single, but should be provided in terms of breakdown. Inadequate information. On page 83, playground and landscaping mulch, $10,000. I thought with all the trees and all the things, the leaves, if we had a relief program and we pick it up for our citizens, which is not proposed in this budget, which I've talked before about, having a leaf sweeping program for our citizens, we could have that mulch and that $10,000. I think the city can apply for a grant to the Department of Natural Resources for that. And again, I don't know why we haven't done so, and if so, when? Because I understand the Department of Natural Resources is very environmentally friendly, and we can have our own mulch with our trees and our limbs and our leaves, brush. Park maintenance building maintenance and materials and supply was zero last year. It's $5,000 this year. Again, it's a number with no support. And again, park maintenance was earlier in the budget in terms of parks. Why is it in Park Improvement Fund? I have no idea. Very, very confusing in the presentation. In terms of on page 85, St. Louis County Municipal Park Planning Grant reimbursed 80%. What are we applying for? It's an $8,000 allocation. What are we applying for? And what's the purpose and use of that particular fund? I would like to see that. I know that the grant, using that number and backing it out that number, that we only go for a grant of $40,000. Or is there more that I don't know because I don't see that? In terms of the oscillating fans, again, it was $16,000, $16,800. The improvements were $15,500. We come in back to the park improvement fund. We go over to the sewer lateral fund. And again, professional services come into play. And on the next page, it better explains it. But what equipment? It says gasoline, $12,000, $15,000 for gasoline in a sewer lateral program. I don't know why that's allocated. I mean, I thought the sewer lateral program is repairing the sewer lines from the house or the sewer to the house. I don't understand why there's gasoline there of $15,000. I don't have any clue on that. On professional services, turning over to the next page on 89, it says audit. Is that a separate allocation for the audit, the city audit of $2,000? It says audit, $2,000, bank fees, et cetera. So we have administrative cross charge, which is again that inter-fund transfers. Administrative cross charge, that's what I like to see because it was transferred back to a cost in terms of the other general fund account from this sewer lateral fund. Other than that, the court I left alone, other than the fact of that building, the acquisition of that, proceeds can be used for land, assembly, and purchase, and construction, maintenance, and upkeep of municipal court, $252,000. Is that the improvement of the building, or as it says here, to be used or can be used for land, assemblance, purchase, construction, maintenance, and upkeep? Is this going to be defined as the building improvement? Is there a plan? Do we have a plan for that? Going back to the administration side that I was looking at, on the administration side, I had questions in terms of the dues. In terms of the dues for that, we have the legislative side of it, and we have the various dues within that building, within that account. We have North County Inc. of $8,325. That's a significant cost to us. I don't know the cost benefit of that. I myself at one time belonged to North County Inc. I didn't find it necessary to belong any further. I joined the chamber, trying to think of a better way of communicating with the community in terms of the businesses. In my opinion, I think it's worthless. Nothing against Rebecca Zoll, but I think at the episode of Ferguson last year, I think that that's not good because I think we got hit hard in terms of publicity in North County, and I didn't see a very reactive North County Inc. on that. St. Louis County Municipal League, I asked about salaries, and I was informed I should contact the Municipal League, but since I'm not a member, I can't acquire that. And to my knowledge, none of the other council members had contact because I have not received anything. So I had to pay some money to the city here to get that information in terms of salaries for this particular year, for three particular years, of some of the staff members, which I have not received, but I'm probably going to receive it shortly. And again, the Engineers Club of St. Louis, what is the purpose of the Engineers Club of St. Louis? Why is that not within the Public Works Department? Or is that the mayor's administrative $190 for his personal dues as an engineer? I think that ought to be a personal, not a city expense. So as I conclude here this evening with all my questions, you understand why the purpose of intervening or at least allowing a person, a citizen, to speak at your work sessions, because there are various questions that should be stated, and I know with all the infinite wisdom of my counsel here that I know you have all the answers, which I hope I've provoked you to better understand what your, again, fiduciary responsibility is to ask the appropriate questions and get the appropriate answers. Don't be shoveled with a shovel full of paper. Anyway, I hope if there's further questions, I'll be more than happy to respond to them. I've enjoyed the opportunity of speaking before the city council. As like Mr. Egan stated to me last year, I had my chance, I did my job here, and now I look forward to listening. And again, I ask the question once again, will I have an opportunity to speak at the work sessions, or will I only sit there and listen? Any response? You're the president of the council, Mr. Egan. So there's no response?
There's no response at this time.
Okay, thank you.
All right. Still seeing no comments from the dais. Is there anyone in the audience that would like to make comment on this public hearing before we close it? Not seeing any, Mr. Lee makes a motion to close the public hearing. That is seconded by myself. All in favor? Aye. Opposed? And the public hearing shall be closed. All business, item number 7. Bills for second reading, and we have none. Item number 8, new business. I would make a motion to amend the agenda for the purpose of appointing a council subcommittee. Seconded by Mr. Lee. Is there any discussion? All in favor? Aye. Opposed? I would like to form a council subcommittee that is to undertake a study of the golf course. I would ask Mr. Lee to chair that committee. I would ask Mr. Shildroff and Mr. Siam to serve on that committee. I would ask you guys return your results of your study to the council in an expeditious manner. Thank you. Board appointments. Your Honor.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'd like to appoint John Jaworski to the Veterans Commission. He's in Ward 9.
Mr. Caputo makes a motion that that appointment be made. That is seconded by Ms. Pagano. Is there any discussion? All in favor? Aye. Opposed? Any appointment shall be made. Thank you. Next item on the agenda, resolutions. Council Resolution 981.
Joint resolution of the Florissant City Council and the Mayor regarding Proposition S.
Mr. Lee makes a motion for a second reading. That is seconded by Mr. Shildoff. Is there any discussion? Mr. Lee.
Yes, I'd ask that the resolution be read once in its entirety.
Is there any discussion? All in favor of the second reading? Aye. Opposed? If you will read the motion in its entirety.
Joint resolution of the Florissant City Council and the Mayor regarding Proposition S. Whereas on November 3rd, 2015, the City of Florissant is asking residents to consider Proposition S, which would provide a quarter cent sales tax to be collected and used for the purpose of providing additional funding for street replacement, repairs, and maintenance. Whereas if approved by the voters, a separate fund will be established for streets and roads, and these funds will not be commingled with the general fund. As such, these funds will be accounted for separately, showing where and how these funds are spent. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the City Council and the Mayor pledge that these funds will be used specifically and exclusively for street replacement, repairs, and maintenance. The funds will not be used for salaries, benefits, snow removals, equipment such as trucks or backhoes, or routine maintenance. Be it further resolved that the City Council and the Mayor pledge that they will continue to provide funds from general fund budget in addition to the new funds, in order to continue our ongoing efforts to provide safe streets for the Florissant, or for the residents of the City of Florissant. This resolution is introduced by the Council as a whole, approved by Mayor Schneider, and passed with the unanimous vote of the Florissant City Council on this 12th day of October 2015.
Thank you very much. Mr. Caputo makes a motion for a third reading. That is seconded by Mr. Hanke. Is there any discussion? We will need a roll call vote, please.
Hanke?
Yes.
Pagano?
Yes.
Schmidt?
Yes.
Siam?
Yes.
Lee?
Yes.
Jones?
Yes.
Egan?
Yes.
Caputa?
Yes.
Shildroth?
Yes.
If you'll read the motion or the resolution for final time.
Joint resolution of the Florissant City Council and the Mayor regarding Proposition S.
Prior to final vote being taken on this resolution, is there anyone in the audience that would like to make comment? Seeing none, clerk, please poll the council.
Hanke?
Yes.
Pagano?
Yes.
Schmidt?
Yes.
Siam?
Yes.
Lee?
Yes.
Jones?
Yes.
Egan?
Yes.
Caputa?
Yes.
Shildroth?
Yes.
Let the record reflect that the resolution has been passed. Thank you. Next item on the agenda, bills for first reading. Bill 9130.
Ordinance to rezone properties currently zoned B4, Highway Commercial District, also known as 2520, 2702, 2700, 2635, 2685, 2705, 2749, and 2775, North Highway 67 to B3 Extensive Business District.
Bill 9131.
Ordinance amending the zoning code section 405-125 B3 Extensive Business District by deleting section 13 Blueprint Shop and moving animal hospital, pet shops, or boarding establishments from special uses to permitted uses.
Bill 9132.
Ordinance approving the community development block grant fiscal year 2016 annual action plan for the city of Florissant, Missouri, and authorizing and directing the mayor to submit such plan to the United States Department of Housing and Urban Development.
Bill 9133.
Ordinance authorizing various transfers within Public Works Department accounts for the end of year budget adjustments.
Bill 9134.
Ordinance authorizing appropriation of $20,000 from the General Revenue Fund to account number 4924 telephones to cover expenses through the end of the fiscal year.
Bill 9135.
Ordinance authorizing an appropriation of $176,500 from the General Revenue Fund to the budget account number 4910 salaries for the overtime expenses for the police department through the end of the fiscal year.
Next item on the agenda. Item number 9, council announcements. Mr. Lee.
Thank you, Mr. President. I just want to say what a great weekend and last week we had in the city of Florissant. Great day in St. Louis on Channel 4, highlighted the city every day last week, culminating in a live broadcast here at City Hall that I think most of us had an opportunity to participate in, and it was just a wonderful opportunity. We had the food truck nights on Friday night. We had a great event at Race to the Shrine on Saturday. Mr. Egan, thank you for your efforts at that. And it all culminated in the highlight of the weekend, which was yesterday at the Fall Festival. And I just want to say I've been involved in the Fall Festival for a lot of years, but this was just an extra special one. And I know I speak for everybody when I want to thank our city clerk, Karen Goodwin, and Diana Weiniger for co-chairing this for the 9th year in a row, and that's what makes it really special. Also want to thank the city staff and police department, everybody that participated. It was a great event. Once again, we had no issues, no problems. There were some quiet things behind the scenes that nobody knows about, but it came off as a great event. But I know you all share my feelings, and you'll probably comment as well, but just a good event for the city. This is what it's all about. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lee. Mr. Hinkey.
Yes, I'm just going to piggyback on what Tim had to say. It was a wonderful weekend. The weather, everything, I talked to the chief, no incidents, seamless. It was just a beautiful weekend. It shows what the true heart of our city is. I'm very proud to be the council person for Ward 6, which had a lot of these things. But I also want to really thank our city employees. They did an outstanding job, as they always do, and I think you can be proud of the money we're spending on our city employees, because we get the bang for our buck, as it was proven this weekend. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hinkey. Mr. Jones.
I'd like to piggyback on these guys about the weekend. It was a beautiful weekend. I hope we have many more of them. I also want to bring up team, you guys at 265 St. Catherine. There's always somebody hungry, morning, noon, and night. Please stop by there and donate, you guys. It counts more than you think it does. I also would like to say a big shout out to a couple in my ward that over the last couple months on the TV stations that come out and say some things by accident that Florissant is a bad draw. They mistakenly use our city on a routine basis when something bad happens. We are the largest community in St. Louis County, but they keep mistakenly using the city of Florissant for some of the things that happen. This couple has spent a lot of hours on the phone straightening some of these things out with the news, Channel 2 News, 4, 5, and all of them. I want to give those guys a shout out for doing that, especially their time. Nobody's asked them to do it. They know it's the right thing to do, and I just want to say thanks to them. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Jones. Mr. Shildroff.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'm going to be looking forward to meeting with residents on Monday, October 19th at the JFK Center at 7 o'clock to talk about Proposition S and anything else they want to talk about in Ward 5. I have some congratulations are in order for a lot of places in town. First on my list is BJ's Pizza that was named the best St. Louis-style pizza in the Best of St. Louis contest in the by the Riverfront Times. Jay Russell and his wife, Delphi, have operated that business. I think it's the longest running business in the city of Florissant, and it's quite an honor to win this award. Also in Sauce Magazine this month, they have a very nice review of our own Pearl Cafe, and I would like to congratulate John and Robin Dietrich, the owners of the Donut Cupboard, for celebrating their 40-year anniversary. The Fall Festival was really special. Well, there's a lot of people to thank, Diane Weidiger, Mr. Lee, Ms. Goodwin, all the volunteers and the groups that made it a great event. However, I will be requesting that the Major K Squad investigate the chili cook-off and the results. I find these results hard to believe, and I hope they get on that case right away. I had a really nice experience on Saturday at one of our businesses, the Office Depot. I was buying some ink for my printer, and I was in line, and a young lady behind me educated me on the on my cell phone to pull up an app where I could get my bill virtually cut in half. And it was a really neat experience, and I didn't know this lady from anything. She just came up to me out of the blue, and I think it's a good example of the type of people we have in Florissant who live here and who shop here. And it really made my day. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Shildroff. I'm going to echo what my colleagues have said about the Fall Festival this weekend. I was able to make all four of those events, the TV broadcast, the Fall Festival, the run, and the food trucks. And I was just absolutely overwhelmed by the work that our employees did. I was overwhelmed at each event, the community that just showed up to be with each other. I'm stealing one of the mayor's lines. On the television show, he said, people in Florissant really don't need the excuse to get together. We just like to get together. And I know I'm paraphrasing. Yesterday afternoon, I stood at the top of Jefferson Street and looked down, and I was amazed. I took a picture in it, and the picture doesn't really capture what I saw. And I tried to estimate in my mind how many people were there that I could see, and there was tens of thousands of people. And it's been pointed out tonight, not one single problem really to speak of. Parks Department, those guys, the Police Department, Street Department, Administration, it was just, I'm just totally amazed. I had friends of mine spend the weekend essentially out here with us from, they moved out of Florissant many years ago, and they were stunned. And they said how much they missed it. And I said, well, why don't you come on home? We'll see if that happens. Secondly, and without being remiss here, I want to wish all my Italian-American friends, Mr. Caputa, the Pagano family, a happy Columbus Day. Your Honor.
Thank you, Mr. Thank you, Mr. President. We had a very well-attended town hall meeting on October 1st. We talked about a lot of the city services that we have for the citizens of Florissant. We also talked about Proposition S, the quarter cent sales tax. This, as you heard earlier, with the resolution and joint resolution from myself and the council, will be used solely for streets. And we also have a meeting for all the wards a week from tonight on October 19th at John F. Kennedy Center, where we will talk pretty much exclusively about Proposition S, but you're welcome to discuss any other issues with your council members. It's our intention to have a combined meeting and then to break up into nine separate meetings to continue. And then on October 29th, we're going to meet one more time about Proposition S at the Egan Center. That's going to be the invitation for next week should have arrived today or tomorrow. Then there'll be another invitation for the 29th. We had a great weekend that included, we already talked about all the different events, with the starting with the food truck night and then the race to the shrine, which Mr. Egan helped organize. The food truck night raises money for team, which Mr. Jones mentioned earlier, very important. Nothing more noble than to feed your hungry brother or sister. As far as good citizenship abounds in our city. And another thing that we had this weekend that wasn't as well known was we had a very large North Star District Scout Jamboree at Sunset Park. And this was 260 Boy Scouts and about 75 adults enjoying our Sunset Park to the fullest. As you approached the campground, it kind of reminded you of maybe what the Native American settlement would look like in a peaceful valley. And I really enjoyed it. They invited me there for lunch Saturday, and I was able to enjoy some fellowship with some of our best citizens, our scouts. And so kudos to them, and I told them they could use our Sunset Park, our Nature Lodge facility, anytime. I want to thank everybody that stopped, took time to talk with me as I was doing my four-hour-plus interview show, Man on the Street, at the Fall Festival. We had a wonderful time, and we were able to talk about a lot of different subjects in a sort of a lighthearted manner, and that'll be on our cable channels. And I also want to thank everybody that made the Fall Festival a success. There's just too many people to mention, but there's so many volunteers that volunteered their time. And I tell you what, it's kind of after the weekend of all these great wholesome activities, I kind of uttered this the other night. It sounds a little corny, but I thought we might have a new slogan to go by, and that would be Florissant, the way the world ought to be. And I think I'm going to close with that.
Thank you, Your Honor. The next meeting in the Florissant City Council will be October 26, 2015, at 7:30 p.m. Mr. Schmidt makes a motion to close the meeting. That is seconded by Mr. Siam. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? The council will stand adjourned.